would run up here and see a man that's proud to be in God's house. The mountains is nice, but it's more better to be in God's house with God's people. Let's all stand up. Here's the reason we come here. We come into his house, magnify his name, worship him.
Swishing back and forth, ain't it, Prince? I praise the Lord. It's a special day.
Amen.
It's always a special day when somebody receives Jesus Christ, their Lord and Savior. Branson had came with his mom the other day, Christy, and he'd come to talk to me about being baptized. And we were going through scriptures, and it was a wonderful blessing to be there. It's the most special times in my life. Is when I see people make decisions for Jesus Christ. Most important thing. So Branson, we gonna get down here, would you, my baby? Do you believe Jesus is the Son of God?
Yes, sir.
Do you believe he died upon the cross of Calvary and rose from the grave bodily on the third day?
Yes, sir.
Have you asked him to forgive you of your sins?
Yes, sir.
Have you accepted him as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
Are you gonna tell others that Jesus it's the only way to salvation?
Yes, sir.
Amen.
I just want to add a little bit to what Brother Blaine was speaking about in the Lord dealing with Branson. This all started, you know, probably a couple months ago. Christy had told me that they was coming home from school and Branson said he wanted to be baptized. And you know, she asked him a couple of questions and all that, and she come told me about it, and I said, well, he's a little young, and baptism is, you know, not all, you know, to salvation, baptism is not just all it contains. Anyway, I talked to Branson a little bit after that, but me being Papa, I'm kind of stern, and he didn't want to talk to me too much about it, but yet, as Brother Blaine spoke about that, he, you know, the Lord was still working on him, and he wanted to talk to Brother Blaine about it, and Brother Blaine spoke to him, and Brother Blaine even mentioned Wednesday night how Branson's heart was feeling, and that's one thing that after he had talked to Brother Blaine, it got me to thinking about what I'd said about him being young. And isn't it great that salvation has nothing to do with age?
Amen.
And salvation is not hard of hearing either. And salvation is not blind. As the Bible says in 1 Samuel says, the Lord does not see, and I'm paraphrasing, does not see as a man sees.
Yes, that's right.
man looks on the outward appearance, but what the Lord looks upon the heart or into the heart. And that's what Jesus was doing. Jesus was tugging at Branson's heart. He knew something was going on because he had heard people like you that brought him up in Sunday school and Bible school and different Bible studies that the Lord, he had heard the word and believed in it, and the Lord was tugging in his heart. And age has got nothing to do with salvation. The Lord always hears those that call out to him in wanting his forgiveness. And the Lord always hears. You know, salvation is about faith. And the Bible addresses that. You know, without faith, you know, there's no salvation. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And without faith, it's impossible to please God in Hebrews. So here today is a day of celebration as us for a family and a family upon another coming to the knowledge of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Branson, as you professed that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, you believe that he's the Son of God, and he died on the cross for your sin, and that he has been raised from the dead, and we'll go to know him when he calls us home, that I baptize you this day in the name of the Father, in the name of Jesus our Savior, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Hallelujah. Brother James is ordained, and I want you to know this, and it's just a wonderful blessing to share, just being able to baptize his grandchild. But let's go to the Lord in prayer, and let's pray in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you so much, God, Lord, just for the blessing of ministry today, God, just be able to come and, Lord, celebrate a new believer, Father. Lord, we thank you so much for his baptism. And I pray, God, Lord, in the name of Jesus, the Holy Spirit will fill him to overflowing, Lord, that you will use this young man to grow up and to be a mighty man of God, that he'll serve you when others laugh, that he'll serve you when others reject, that he'll serve you when there's not crowds around, that he'll serve you when they don't have all these things. But, Lord, he just wants to have a heart for you. Bless him, Lord. I pray that you direct his path, his footsteps, Lord. And I pray, God, that we will see other people make decisions for Christ. Lord, we pray today, God, Lord, as we gather together as a family, that you will bless this service. Because, Lord, we come to you as the only hope, the only help that we can ever have that truly matters, Father. I pray today, God, Lord, for one of our little sisters that's in the hospital today. I pray for Kyla, Lord, in the name of Jesus. That, Lord, here it is, Lord, you know what she needs. And we pray, God, your hand upon her family, Father, that you bless them, that you encourage them, that you surround them with a hedge of angels, Father, that the Holy Spirit would give them comfort during this time. We pray your hand of ministry upon them, Lord. I pray, God, through this, as people will see that they need Jesus, Father. Lord, I thank you so much for Kyla. I thank you so much for her smile. I thank you so much, Lord. Lord, for her toughness, God. Bless her, Lord. Bless her. Bless this service, Father, as we sing praises to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Took her to the mountains, and this is the way I get treated. Okay, here we go. A couple announcements right quick. Tonight, starting at 5 o'clock, choir practice time. Choir practice at 5 o'clock. We're going to really get started serious about the Christmas program. 6 o'clock, we're going to have Experience of God Bible study. Be here for it. Tomorrow night at 6:30, men's Bible study. If you would like to come, we would love to have you come and just hear. And we don't do a lot of focus on anything except God's word. Think about that. We got a note up here to share. I think it's a cool thing. On the back table, there's a shoebox where you can write down. Make sure I get your email and your address if you want to have it in a shoebox where that someone gets it, might can contact you. It'll be put in there. So leave it on the box. shoebox in the back. Just write your email and address on there if you want to. You don't have to. You want to, they'll put them in the shoebox we send out. The kids can contact you and tell you that they got it. It'll be a mail order. You can contact them and minister to them and kind of reach out to them. Next Sunday night, Glenda's going to be working with the kids on Bible drill. So if you have a child who would like to come, you've been saying, well, I can't come, there's nothing for my kids at the Experience of God. They're going to start working on Bible drill and learning how to find scripture and learn scripture and know scripture. So be prepared for that. Anything else?
I got one.
Go, Bert. This afternoon, if y'all didn't hear that, they're going to take the youth and any adults want to go to Judgment House in Tylertown. Sixth grade? Was it youth grade?
I suggest
seventh grade.
Sixth grade and up.
It's very intense. It's a very intense place. It really tells a story about what life is without Jesus if you die.
I don't suggest any little
children. No, I don't think any. I think it would scare me, all me and all the little ones. Anything else? One more thing, go.
Please fill out a card. This would, I'm guaranteed to get a response, but possibly you could, and that would be awesome. Also, we're going to plan a packing party at 6 o'clock Wednesday the 16th. Anybody wants to come. We're going to get the youth involved and finish up our packing. We've got to get them out by the 17th.
All right, sounds good. Wednesday the 16th. Pistilo, go. Okay, all you committees, if you're on a committee and you don't have a chairperson, Ms. Tilo's going to come to your house and beat it out of you. That's what you said. If you have a problem, call 1-800-TILO.
Brother Tyler, I just wanted to say real quick, thank you to everybody that helped yesterday. I think we had a great time. It was a great success, and I think we exemplified what Christ would want from us in service. So I just wanted to say thank you for everybody that helped and those that prayed for us as well. Thank you.
And buddy, that I'm going to say, when we had the cakewalk, I had my phone playing the music. There was a couple of songs, and one of them come on, it was, and Jessica looked at me and said, some people just kind of raised their eyebrows at your music. But it was all about Jesus. So, speaking of that, let's stand up. Let's have a little talk with Jesus. Let's worship. Here we go.
I once was lost in sin, but Jesus sent me in. And then the light from heaven filled my soul. It made my heart in love and wrote my name above. And just as long as Jesus made me whole. Now let us have a talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our trouble. He will hear our pain. He will answer us.
once you have a little talk with Jesus, there's something you got to do. You can't just talk to Jesus and then go do what you want to do. When you talk to him, you got to trust that he's talking to you and obey what he's saying. Trust and obey, because there's no other way.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. Let us do his good will. He abides with us.
Come on, sing it, song.
And with all who will trust him.
Trust and obey, and we remember what kind of days we're living in. We ain't just living in regular days.
No.
These are the days of Elijah. But guess what? He's coming. These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord.
These are the days of Elijah.
Thank you. last thing. When you realize all of that, oh, when you realize all that, you realize how great God is. How great thou art. Oh, I'm worshiping. I don't know whether y'all are. No, it's good. Y'all choir, y'all can be seated. Oh, mercy. They can be seated. Y'all gotta go. Mercy. The word special music is bandied about as any time someone comes up and sings by themselves. But the true thing about special music is any time God's people sing from their heart. If you ride in your car by yourself, just you and God, you singing your heart out, that's special music.
Amen.
And when you're willing to stand up here in front of everybody else, that makes it even more special. I have sung with many people. I've sung all over the United States. But I got three guys who will come here and sing with me this morning that make my heart smile. Not because they're great, not because they're pretty, but because, folks, these boys love the Lord. And if you don't love the Lord, then why are you here? Let me and Brother Lane talk to you about it. We can tell you about it. Rasta can tell you about it. So at this time, I need my all-star quartet to come out.
Oh.
Now, look, we're going to be taking up money to buy us a bus after this. So, we didn't want Deb to come here and mess up our songs. We sing it from Acapulco.
What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this I plead. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing can for sin atone.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Not for good that I have done.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all my hope and peace.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all my righteousness.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Transform in your home, in this world. Now, it's going to sound funny to you. You let the men start getting fired up for Jesus.
Amen.
You let men get where they can. This particular group you see right here, that's part of the men's Bible study. It's been going on for months. And I'm telling you, it don't matter if Tyler's there, it don't matter if I'm there. These guys meet and they do a Bible study. And not only each one takes a little turn, what seems impossible as I'm talking, none of them started out doing this within themselves, but the Holy Spirit has led them. Each one takes a Monday night and they teach Bible. Now, how many of you said you can't do it? Now, I want you to think now. These guys get up here and start giving their testimonies that will absolutely amaze you. Just what God is doing through them. Dare I say, most probably haven't prayed out loud. They all pray out loud. They're all teaching a Bible study on different times. They're not made to do this. This is just something the Lord's doing in their lives. And there's other ones also involved in this. But that's the great thing. If you really want to see something take place, start letting the Holy Spirit direct your path. Start letting God have all of you, and just a portion, instead of just a portion, let him have 100%. I heard a woman testify today on the news, and she says, she talked about how God had led her to run for a particular office. Now, here's the thing. She had never run for office before, and she says, you can't give God 50%. You got to give him 100%. And she talked about how God had led her to a scripture and showed her what she needed to do. You know, God's still speaking today. As a matter of fact, that's kind of what I'm referring to today. If you'll open your Bibles to Daniel chapter 3, verse 16, and we'll read verse 16 to 17. And if you're physically able, would you stand with me a moment if you're physically able? If you're not, that's okay. But it's all right. So this is one of the ones that probably you already have highlighted in your Bible. But let's just look at this. And this is one of my favorite ones. And this is some stuff this the Lord was speaking to me about. It says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to give you an answer concerning this matter. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the furnace of blazing fire, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. As she said, it's just our opening verses. Father, we give you praise and glory, Father, for the examples in the Bible, Lord, of godly people who stood up against, Lord, persecution. I pray, Father, that each one of us will be bold in the Spirit, willing to stand up when the persecution comes. To you be the glory. In Jesus' name we pray it all. Amen. You may be seated. You know, it's so easy for each one of us to say that God's never will never give us more than we can stand. When you're sipping on iced tea with a little bit of lemon and eating boiled shrimp, it's easy to talk about these different things. But what happens when the fire starts to get hot up under you? What happens when it starts to get kind of warm and you feel the heat? When it looks like your house is going to burn down because of the circumstances that's surrounding you? When you're put out there and you're standing kind of like Job and you're looking at yourself and it looks like you've lost everything and appears that you're going to have nothing left and you feel alone. What's going to take place? Is God still with us in that kind of fire? Is God still with us when it feels like everything's going against you? When you're under persecution? When you got things threatened against you? What will you do? And how will you react? You might find it silly when I talk about it, but when the heat is turned on, you feel like the next straw, like a straw that's put on a camel's back. You ever heard that old saying? One more straw, break that camel's back. You feel like one more thing happened, one more stuff happened that you can't take more. It's going to crush you down. And you might even be sitting there wondering, where's God? Or maybe if God's with me. Or maybe, why am I walking through the fire? Or there's all sorts of questions that start coming to your heart there. There's a lot of times when God doesn't fix it, but he allows you to walk through the fire. You ever heard that before? You see, he lets us walk through pain. He lets us walk through loss. And you may have to walk through letting go of something or even someone that you believed was going to be the dream that you thought was the answer. Sometimes we got to walk through the agony of seeing someone we love sick, or you feel the pain of a friend betraying you, or friends even. Have you been there? I believe if you're a Christian, you've probably been there. Why? Why? But you feel the pain way down deep, and you see all these broken pieces. You see all this stuff that's been shattered. And you say, man, there's no way that'll ever fit back together. There's no way this is ever gonna get fixed. When you read these particular scriptures right here, there's something that's taking place. And I mean, here it is, these Bible friends, and probably the majority of you have heard these Bible stories in your Sunday school class, and you've heard me preach on it before. They are these close buddies, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And man, they're being put through it. Now, I want you to remember, when you think about this story right here, they had been stolen out of their land. They had been taken over there from their homes. They had been taken from their place of worship right there. And they had been held for years in captivity. Now, as they're right there, they're being trained. They're being educated. They're getting all these great things. But I'm going to tell you, the same ones that were educating them, the same ones that was teaching them, the same ones that was kind of bringing them in right there, is the same ones that's put them in the situation that you read about. But they wouldn't back down from their conviction. When you read that story and not look at it, they refused to move away from their beliefs. And you know, in life today, we're going to be always pushed to move away from your belief.
You're always going to, and it's not going to come from the direction you think it is. You're always going to be pushed that there's something else needed. There's something else needed. There's something more needed. There's something more than Jesus Christ. There's something more than going to church. There's always something, and it's going to be different than what you think. Now, God's always with me is about to become more than the simple words that are sliding off their lips. See, it's easy when you're sitting here and we're all at church on Sunday and we say, well, God's always there with me. But what about when you feel the heat? A lot of people, really, they can relate to the story that you see right here. A lot of people, they feel close to it, not because we've been in a real fire, but we sure felt like it's been that way. We sure felt like the heat was on there. We sure felt like we've been through it. You felt the fire as you walked through life. You felt the fire as you have attended school. You felt the fire as you went to college. You felt the fire as you went to your workplace. You felt the fire in your marriage. You felt the fire in your financial situations. These guys right here, as you look at these friends, they walked through the fire, but God didn't fix it. I want you to look at this. You see, it staged over and over throughout life. Sometimes people wonder where God is while all this stuff's happening. You ever feel that way? And I'm just being honest. You ever feel that way? Where's God at in this? See, God was there, and he's always there. But what about when it doesn't look that way? What about when it looks like you're there, maybe things are happening way different than you ever thought it would? We go through loss that we prayed we wouldn't have to. We see things we prayed we never have to see. We walk through places where it feels lonely. And here it is. They were with a group of friends. Yet how do you imagine they felt when those same group of friends are saying, put them in the fire? You see, God is with us when it's hard and when it's hot. See, that's the one thing I believe is so important. As we walk as Christians, it's not just like yesterday. By the way, that was just fabulous yesterday. I just praise the Lord, all the different testimonies I heard. And it was more than just a bunch of kids stuff. Praise the Lord for that. I praise the Lord for that. But the Lord was moving out there. And I got to hear so many testimonies. But sometimes we're allowed to walk through hard, hot things of life. Have you had to do it yet? I got to contemplating it as I was sitting there. And I was actually thinking about my children. And I was thinking about the different things and that had happened ever since I've been in ministry, traveling all across this country. And I have heard stuff you just wouldn't believe. And it never comes from where you think it is. Because we out there, we're teaching our kids, it's going to be something that's going to be non-Christian. It's never that way, at least from what I'm experiencing. But I understand something. I believe the Bible points out, he's trying to teach us that no matter what's taking place, that he's more than sufficient. He's trying to teach us that we can trust it and lean into him. Yes. Lean into the master, the real him, not the catchphrase, not all the cliches, not all the emojis, but I'm talking about the real God, because the real God will be there through all of this. But God gets us through all of these situations. But God is the one who carries us through. The God who directs our steps when we feel like we've been blinded. The God of our life is there on the good Fridays we have and the bad Mondays. He's always there. The God who's still there when you feel alone. You might be sitting here today. You might be sitting in this church, and you might feel all alone. You might feel like no one understands. There's always amazing, because people go through all sorts of emotions. If you've ever been in ministry, if you've ever been someone who is a servant of God, you understand that there's things that's always taking place. The God who's still there, even when I feel like I'm by myself, he's right there. See, all we can do is recognize the voice of the shepherd. When you, y'all remember that story, and every preacher uses this. I've used it several times. But so the shepherd's out there, and you got to picture this. The shepherd carries this particular staff. And as he's taking care of his sheep, they have lambs sometimes that drift away from the flock. Now, what happens with a lamb? You know a lamb can't protect, even a sheep. A coyote can wipe out hundreds of sheep in one night. He just goes around and cuts their throat. Sounds horrible. So when the shepherd has a particular lamb that's giving him all sorts of troubles, y'all remember how he corrects that behavior? He breaks their back legs. What? I want you to remember. Then he takes that lamb, this is true, and he puts it on his shoulders, and he carries that lamb till it heals back up. And you know what he's teaching that lamb? He's teaching him to stay close. See, God breaks us, right, of ourselves and our self-reliance. And you could be doing good financially. You could be doing all sorts of stuff. But I'm going to tell you something. Until you understand what it means to be reliant upon God for everything that you possess and understand dependency, the things that we're taught not to experience, here's what he says. He wants all of you, not the little portion. He wants all of you. He wants you to trust him. He wants you to get off the couch and start believing that he is more than able. He brings us to these situations that's hard. He brings us to places we never thought we'd go through, so that you have no choice but to depend upon the master. Sometimes we got to get our legs broke. But there's times when that broken season in our lives isn't fixed right away. Have you been there? Have you been in that situation? And what God does is he lets us walk in it. He lets you walk through the furnace. He lets others throw you into the furnace. You'd never expect. And what he does, he's making a point to prove to them that God is still in control in every situation. I mean, maybe the furnace isn't to break you or destroy you, but to make you. Now think, so if you want a really good pot, what does the potter have to do? He has to fire that piece of pottery. You got to be put through the fire to really be the one that Christ wants you to be, so that it burns away the stuff that's trying to root into your life, to burn away the stuff that will keep you from being all you can be for the glory of Jesus Christ, to let you see that somebody like you, that somebody like me, that his hand is upon us. The people that throw you in, they're saying, well, we see him walking around, and who's that with him? Now, what do you think their hearts were doing at that moment? We threw three of them in, and we see one as the Son of God. Amen. We see one that's walking through the fire with them. See, I'm going to tell you something. That stuff that tries to keep you in bondage, that stuff that tries to keep you from being all you should be for the glory of God, that's where the furnace is pretty handy, ain't it? When it really gets hot, and then you know the master's walking through it with you.
Amen.
God could have took out the fire. God could have destroyed the furnace. God could have did all sorts of things right there. But he let them walk through it. Sometimes you're going to have to walk through a fire, but you won't walk alone. In the heat of the fire, when you understand that God is right there sustaining you and showing others what he can do. Can you imagine these soldiers who threw these men into the fire? Can you imagine their hearts, their eyes? Can you imagine what was taking place? Our biggest storms can be the brightest lighthouse of hope to the people that are lost and dying. I want you to understand this. I pray I'm able to deliver this where you understand that I'm not the most eloquent preacher. but I pray you understand the sincerity. God has a purpose in everything that we go through.
Amen.
He's in control of all. See, people are in the storms all around us right now. You know what they're looking for? A safe harbor. I went fishing a few weeks back with my wife, and I just took her away from the house. I just took her. And, you know, it don't take much to make us happy. We go fish. That's about it. I mean, that's about as exciting as we get, I guess. We enjoy it. But when we was down there, and I don't know where to go fish along that Gulf Coast down there, I just drove, really just driving and seeing. But there was this location. Now, I found out that pre-Katrina, there used to be this giant casino there. It was a good fishing place, by the way. But you know what it was? It was leveled out. But you know what was interesting to me as I was looking at it? I was thinking about this. There was still a lighthouse on the corner. The casino had been totally destroyed, but there was a lighthouse. The wind had, I mean, it was, I couldn't recognize it from nothing. I knew there had to be something there. There's people that are looking for the safe place to be. And when they see God taking you through the fire, when they see God and that He's in the fire with you, and that you're not going through it by yourself, but the master of all creation's right there. It's not always about God keeping the bad things away from my life. It's not always about that. Or fixing the broken season of my life. Sometimes it's about who's in the fire with you.
Amen.
Now, a lot of times, you look around to your family and your friends, and I see it said a lot, like, you know who really is your friend when you go through the fires and all this kind of stuff. And that's good. There's nothing wrong with that, because your Christian brothers and sisters should be right there. But when you understand when the master, the creator, that he is right there. See, God will see us through it. He'll see. All we have to do is trust Him, rely upon Him, lean into Him. God's even in control, even when it doesn't feel that He's in control.
Amen.
It says it. I believe it. And when you are affirmed in it, it brings a peace in the midst. He didn't leave Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego when the king said, put them in the fire, boys. You know what? I don't think that fire's hard enough. Put a little bit more coal up in there. Get that dude hotter now. But God stepped through time into the fire with them. Now think. He stepped into that situation. He's the God of the hills, right? But He's also God of the valley. See, you're never in this life alone. So many times when you feel like it, and you're in this situation, and you've become so, your eyes have become so affixed upon the situation. But when life is hot, when life is rough, when life is unfair, God will be with you.
Amen.
It says in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 2 and 3. Look at what this says. He says, when you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God. Watch. The Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I have given Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in your place. When you look at these scriptures, when you understand that the master of all creation is right there with you, it transforms your ability to withstand the heat. Everyone who hears the voice, my voice when I'm speaking, you know, my family watches, there's several families who are watching on the computers, and you know, it's always a week back. My mama, when I go home, she'll say, well, there you are on the TV, and you're over here walking in the door. You know, I said, Mom, they got the YouTube is how it is. You're watching what I preached last week. And she's always amazed at that. But I'm going to tell you something. I got some good news and I got some bad news for everybody who can hear me. The bad news is we'll all go through the fire. makes you want to stand up and just shout and dance around and say, "Whoo, hallelujah." It'll be different for each one of us. Every single one of us are going to go through a different kind of fire. Every single one of us are going to go through different kinds of situations. Every single one of us are going to go through things that you never expected to happen. Every single one of us are going to have situations that may bring tears to your eyes. Every single one of us. But the grace of God is sufficient to see you through.
Amen.
The love of God will never leave you nor forsake you. Through the seasons that each one of us are passing, through these seasons, no matter how hot, no matter how dark it seems, when we look at the things that's going on, the God of all creation, the King of Kings, right? Your Heavenly Father, He's with you. He in the midst of the flames, He's in control. What? That's right. He's transforming us. He's changing us. He's making us stronger in the spirit, more dependent upon Him. See, the fire can break the things that breaks you, or the tool that God uses to refine you. When you understand it, the one who sets the stars in place and he knows them by name, the one who sets the ocean boundaries and he says, "Don't go no further," the one who stood in the furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is the one who stands with you.
Amen.
It's not just some kind of story. It's not just some kind of cliche. It's not some kind of emoji. It's the truth. And when you understand the truth, when you become closer to Jesus Christ as a born-again believer, it's transforming, and you understand things a little differently. Becoming a Christian doesn't keep you from going through fire.
Amen.
There goes 50% of the population right there. Grow in the church, brother. Now, so my son is a fireman, and you know, and all these other credentials. And he went through a fireman's school. He trained and trained and trained for months, and he took all these classes. Matter of fact, on top of these classes, he's took hazmat, and he's took all these different things with explosives and containments and rescue. He took all these things as a fireman. Let me ask you, when he took all those classes, do you think he did it because he never thought he'd go through a fire? See, he knew that he was trained to handle everything as a fireman. So the situations, I could never even, it'd be spooky to me. Certain things that he was going through, and there was a massive explosion on I-12 one time, and I say, son, you know, the concerns about your one of your sons being injured or hurt. He says, "Dad," he said, "I was trained how to handle all this stuff." He says, "I know how to deal with all this stuff." See, he gets trained. You know why the fireman gets trained? To rescue those who are trapped, to minister to those that can't escape, who don't know how to deal with it. See, we as born-again believers, it's almost like we have a big crosshair on our back. And it says, "Here's the target." But God's with you. You may have the big mark on your back says, "Drop a bomb here upon you." But the God of all creation is right there. And you as a child of the King, the reason we go through the Bible studies is not to just strengthen our mind, that's a great thing, but so that our heart will be affirmed with the truth when the fire is hot. That God's with us. That when we go through these situations, that the Holy Spirit brings into remembrance those things that will encourage us at the midnight hour. See, you got a flame sometimes that seems like it surrounds you. But His grace is sufficient to get you through. When the heat of life and the government, all these different things seem so unbearable, He'll see you through the season. He'll get you to the other side, and you won't have the stench of smoke clinging to you. I don't know how you perceive the message, but the message is you're not alone. That He's with you. Do you understand? No matter what you're feeling, when Satan throws something against you, He's with you. Today, each one of us have decisions to make. So Branson, he's made a decision for Jesus Christ. And you say, well, that's fine. He's 9 years old. You see, Jesus came for all who hears the call. Yeah. And what we have to do is respond to the wooing of the Holy Spirit as He draws us. Now, I'm going to tell you, if you want to walk through fire, you've got to understand the Word. And you won't understand the Word until you dig deeper into the Word. And you won't dig deeper into the Word until you get out of your comfort zone. Amen. And as you get into that Word, you understand, through it all, Christ is with you. If you could bow your heads just a moment. If you've never given your heart to Jesus, maybe you've been kind of just stumble-stepping. You haven't clearly been walking for Jesus. Maybe you need to rededicate your life. If you've never given your heart to Christ, you need to get saved. And you don't need to wait to a better day when the chicken ain't burning on the stove. You need to get right now. Maybe it's time to just say, Lord, I've seen too much of the furnace. I've seen too much of the people trying to throw me in the furnace. And Lord, I've been seeing You. Lord, let me see You. Let me see You, Father. For Lord, I want the peace that You promised in the Word. God is who He says He is. You'll never be disappointed. I'm telling you. We're only disappointed in the flesh. I'm telling you, He keeps His Word. I want you to look back. Look back. Did He ever not do what He said He would do? This is the opportunity. These altars are open. As the Holy Spirit leads you, I would ask you to respond. I would ask you to just be obedient. Just let the Lord lead you. Let the Lord lead you. Won't you come as the Lord calls?
Just as I am without one plea, but that Thy blood was shed.
Cajun buddy brought you up. Come up on here. Come on, Gino and Miss Kathy, if y'all can stand a moment. Come on down here. Y'all get up. Y'all get lined up too. Y'all come on now. It's just all us cousins. Christy, it's all us. So this is my Cajun buddy right here. And this is his Yankee wife that he married out of Lane. So what state's that you from?
Well, originally Colorado.
Okay, that's good enough. So you can't get much north of that, huh? So anyway, she's coming down for baptism. Right? Gino, which I told him, I said, I thought you done joined. He said, we want to join the church. All right? So Gino wants to come in. She's going to come in by baptism. But is there a motion to accept my brother and my sister? She's going to come by baptism. He's going to come by a letter somewhere. We'll get a letter. He's always serving in church. Was here before. All right? There's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Y'all we stay got here just.
Oh, yeah. we're peacemakers. Hallelujah. I just want y'all to know, I'm fine with Ole Miss. I rooted for Ole Miss. Listen, when they was down, the preacher got down and prayed. Say, Lord, if you don't help them, half of my church is going to be weeping and staying home, Lord. God is good. So we're good all the way around. And then, of course, my buddy, my little buddy, Branson. I wish I had the Bible right here. I want to show you his Bible he's got. But this is his baptism certificate right here. So what I want you to do, I want you to come down here, if you would, and I want you to shake their hands and you know, just tell them. I want you to look at their faces. I want you to pray for them. I want you to pray. Addison, how long ago was you baptized, Addison?
Last
year during the cuckoo, all the flus and the COVIDs and all this kind of stuff. Still serving the Lord, hallelujah. She's back here serving. What a blessing in my life, in all of our lives for these young people. Pray for each one of these that they will grow to be mighty servants of the Lord. Pray for these. They were out there working yesterday and stuff. That they will serve the Lord with gladness. That he will use each and every one to extend the ministry. It's about being the lighthouse. It's about being the lighthouse, right? God's going to make, you're going to be okay. If you're going through it, you didn't feel like coming to this altar, I want you to know, you're going to be okay. You're going to be okay because God is with us, right? You going to come down, Connie Sue? You going to take a picture? You got it?
Why are you going to bust me out like that?
Connie, you can't start whispering now.
Why?
Did you get a picture? Get some
picture. Right here.
Okay, get a picture. Make me look thinner though. Do that thing you do all the time. Don't put no ears on me. Don't put them ears and all that stuff on me.
All right, let me get a good picture all the way. All right, everybody
look at. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. All right. My brother, dismiss us in prayer if you would.
Lord God, you are great and mighty. Lord, this day has been an amazing worship service of you, God. I thank you for it. I thank you for the baptism of our young brother, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the one that come forward and join our church in baptism. The family, Lord, that you've given. God, I'm unworthy, God, to be here, but God, you allow us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Be with us now as we go to our homes, God, as we prepare, Lord. I pray, Lord, we will serve you.